Good morning.
It's a little loud this morning.
Good morning. Welcome to worship on this beautiful sunshiny day. Just a couple of announcements this morning. There will be a short SPRC meeting right after church just to get a couple dates that folks are available. So if you are an SPRC, just we'll probably just meet back in this room over here right after the worship service so we can talk about some dates so we can get together since it's that time of year to have the annual review. So are there any other announcements? Oh, we also have, don't forget the milk giveaway is the last one scheduled so far. So the milk giveaway this coming Wednesday at Casey's. Any other announcements this morning? All right. Well, let's open our worship in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you join me in the prayer for illumination? Loving God, call us together as your people. Transform us with your love. Transform our hearts that we may love generously. Transform our eyes that we may see your grace. Transform our hands that we may serve in your name. Transform our spirits that we may be the body of Christ, gathered in worship and sent out to serve. Amen. Our call to worship this morning is from a familiar psalm. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. We belong to God. When we feel overwhelmed, God is on our side. When we are afraid, God will keep us safe. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Blessed be the Lord. Amen. Let's join together as we meditate on the words from our opening hymn, number 545, The Church's One Foundation.
Thank you.
scripture reading for this morning is found in Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 20. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you be in an attitude of prayer with me? Lord, we just thank you once again for this beautiful day of sunshine that we can be gathered here in your name. Lord, we just ask your blessing upon our service this morning. And Lord, I just especially ask that you fill me up with your spirit so the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, are known to be your words and not mine. Amen. So I got a question for you this morning. Who's your favorite hero? Do you have a favorite hero? You know, maybe we ought to start with a definition, right? So the dictionary says, a hero is a person who is admired or idealized for courage, outstanding achievement, or noble qualities. For example, a war hero. A hero is a real person or a main fictional character who, in the face of dangers, combats adversity through their strength and through their ingenuity and courage. So if you think of somebody in your past that you think of that might be fit those definitions, who is your favorite hero? You know, who? William Westmoreland. There you go. See, somebody's answering me this morning. That's great. So you knew him, yeah, and he was a great general, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
So who do you think of as a hero? Maybe a grandma or a grandpa or an aunt or an uncle or maybe a special friend? Or maybe you think back to some of you that had childhoods that involved comic books and maybe you're thinking, oh, well, maybe Batman or Superman or Wonder Woman or Captain America or maybe even Spider-Man. Boy, that would be great if I could be like them. They were a great hero. They're always after the, you know, the people, saving people from dangers and things like that. But heroes typically don't like to call attention to themselves, do they? They like to build others up and take kind of the back seat, so to speak, or even hide their identities at times. Sometimes the person you'd never ever guess would work out to be a hero. They're probably the least suspect. If somebody you had to label as a hero, probably wouldn't even think of that, right? But if you, I grew up on comic books, and one of the lines that I remember reading out of a comic book story was from Spider-Man's Aunt May. You know, she was the woman that took young Peter in when he lost his parents. And she said to Peter one day, "We all need a hero, someone courageous and sacrificing people, setting examples for all of us. Everybody loves a hero. People line up for them, cheer for them, scream their names, and years later tell how they stood in the rain just for hours to get a glimpse of the one who told them to hold on just a second longer. I believe there's a hero in all of us that keeps us honest, gives us strength, and makes us noble. We got, you're right, Kenny. We got a lot of people out there that are heroes. Those that are serving our communities, wearing the badges, wearing the dog tags, protecting our country. Those are EMS guys, our firemen, our EMS first responders. All those people are our real heroes if we stop and think about it, right? And it takes quite a bit to kind of live up to those standards to be called a hero, doesn't it? In our scripture lesson today, we have Jesus and his disciples as the overall characters, if we think of this as a story. And our two main characters from this reading are Jesus and Peter. Now, Jesus is asking his disciples just a couple questions. He starts out most innocently by asking, "Who do people say that I am?" To which he gets a wide variety of answers. First, there's answers of people who are now dead in that time with Jesus. It's as if Jesus somehow was the reincarnation of one of these prophets from old, such as Elijah. Now, one of the reasons that people were saying that is because Elijah was to come again before the rule of God, or that was what was written in Malachi chapter 4, verse 5, where Malachi is revealing what God spoke to him when he said, "Lo, I will send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes." So that's basically, he was foretelling the end of the world and saying that this great prophet was going to come again, someone that people admired and thought of in those times that Malachi lived, which were many years after Elijah. He had been heroized, so to speak, and was thought of to be that great hero of faith at that time. And then Jesus asked the next question, "Who do you say that I am?" And then Peter, great Peter, he responds right away, "Well, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." To which Jesus responded to him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter," and that seems a little bit strange, "you are Peter, right? And I will, on this rock, I will build my church." So here we have Jesus, who's really our real hero, now telling Simon Peter that he will be a hero. And Jesus calls him by this name Peter, which in the Greek, the name is Petros, meaning stone or a solid rock. And Jesus is telling them, "Upon you, Peter, this, I'm going to call you my solid rock. I'm going to call you, quit calling you Simon, son of Jonah. I'm going to start calling you Peter, and because you are the rock. You are going to be the one that going to go out and build the church on this earth in my name to give glory to our Heavenly Father." Peter is destined to become an unlikely hero. Here he is, a lowly son of a fisherman, but yet he is destined to become someone great. And actually have letters written by him and people documenting him in the Bible. And wow, somebody to look forward and look up to. Peter, impetuous Peter, full of answers and quick to respond, but who always didn't get it right, if you remember, right? Did Peter always get it right? No. What happened in the Garden of Gethsemane? He impetuous, "I'm going to pull up my sword, I'm going to cut off the ear, and I'm going to protect you, Jesus." And Jesus is like, no, relax, Peter. It's okay. It'll be all right. Peter, who denied Jesus when he was on trial, he doesn't always get it right, but he's faithful and he truly believes in Jesus. He just sometimes doesn't connect all the dots, so to speak, right off the bat. But he does eventually get it right. He grows in that relationship. He grows into being that great hero. You know how sometimes if we look closely at Scripture, perhaps we see another meaning other than the one that is plainly written on the page. Perhaps this may be one of those times in terms of the questions that Jesus was asking the disciples. You know, he asked, who do people say I am? And then he asked, who do you say that I am? That begs the question, is Jesus just curious about what people are saying about him, what the local gossip is, so to speak, going around about him? Is he giving the disciples a test, maybe? A test to see if they understand who Jesus is saying, who he really is. And then remember that Jesus is talking to his disciples, his followers, his students, those that are studying under him, under his leadership, to become like him. They're to emulate Jesus, because that's what students did that were students of rabbis. They emulated their rabbis and kept so they could continue to teach just like the rabbi that taught them would teach. Maybe this question really isn't about who do you say I am, but it may be to get them to realize the question that he's asking is really one about a relationship. Their relationship with Jesus. How well do you understand me, perhaps? Or maybe the question is more of, who are you in me, is what Jesus is asking them. That's a question that we all should be asking ourselves as followers or disciples of Jesus, isn't it? Who are we in Jesus? Now, perhaps Jesus is calling his disciples, that's both them at that time and you and me today, to be self-aware of who we are in him. He's really asking, how is your relationship with me? How is your relationship with God our Father? Are you aware of who you are in me? You know, there's a Jesuit prayer that helps the prayer ponder and ask God to reveal where he's been present in their life. And it goes something like this. Ask God, where did I sense your presence the most in my day? God, when did your presence seem furthest away from me in my day? God, how were you loving me in my day? And finally, God, how were you loving me even when your presence seemed so far away from me? And the very last question, God, how did I respond to your love this day? Those are some pretty powerful questions, aren't they? And they're all tying back to understanding who we are and recognizing God active in our life each and every day. Who are we in Jesus? Who are we when we can feel his presence or God's presence in our life? Who are we when God seems so far away, when we're going through something or something's come up that we just don't think God's right there with us, maybe right there. We're starting to question ourselves. But then if we reflect after the end of the day, or maybe it takes longer than that, maybe it's a week or a month or a year to reflect back, and then we can say, you know what? God truly was with me during those times as well, even when I didn't feel that presence close to me. So what this is really saying to us is that we can grow into more of a hero in Christ. We can grow into who we truly are in Jesus. And through that relationship with Jesus, we can understand who we are in God. We can recognize that God is always with us, Even when we feel and acknowledge his presence in our life, and even when we don't think or feel of his presence in our life. The goal of these questions are to help us become self-aware. Now, these self-aware questions help us to take a moral inventory of ourselves. There's many different programs out there, like, for example, AA or other self-help or 12-step programs that are out there. And these are questions that they ask people every day. Who are you? And they start with that when they're their broken selves. Who are you to this day? And then as you reflect and think about things and go through the 12-step programs, those questions take on a different meaning. Who are you transforming into this day? Who are you emulating? Who are you becoming more and more like this day? See, we too can become more and more like Jesus. And we have to become more aware of our identity in our day. But also, these questions also serve to help us form a new identity in Jesus. If we're struggling with something, we can form that new identity and put away that old self. If we've been sinning and asking for forgiveness for something, we've wronged somebody in some way and ask for that forgiveness, we can change. Humans have the ability to change who they are, to become someone a bit different and put away those old things. I mean, after all, we don't, probably still don't act like little kids the way we did it at 5 or 7 years old, do we? Maybe we slip back into that sometimes, but for the most part, we don't think back, or we don't think the same ways we did when we were 5 or 7, or even 10 or 12. And sometimes even 16 to 18 year olds, we don't think the same ways today that we did back then, except for those that are 16 to 18 year old range, right? But you can relate from those earlier age. You don't think and act and do those same things. You know, we all change, and we have that ability to change. That's with our thoughts, our ideas, and our identity in Christ as well. It helps us, or another way of putting this is, it can help us, these questions, to become the solid foundation of who we are in Christ, so that we can become a hero for somebody and save their life by bringing them into relationship with Jesus. In order to develop our hero mission, which is to love, welcome, nurture, and serve all people by following the example of Jesus, we too have to know ourselves. We have to know our challenges and limitations. We have to know where we're not perfect and need forgiveness. And then where we need to get into a better relationship with God. And also understand the gifts and special abilities that we also have that can bring us and help us in fulfilling that mission. God's granted each and every one of us a special gift of some sort or another. And sometimes it takes a lifetime for us to figure out what that gift is. But I know for certain that he's given us at least one special gift that we can reach one person that we need to at least. And knowing who we are helps others. It helps others get to know us. And also, because we're willing to share, but it also helps us to know what we need and where we need to develop and grow ourselves. I read a saying on a sign outside of a church earlier this week that said, to hear God, turn down the volume of the world. To hear God, turn down the volume of the world. And isn't that so true? Sometimes we get so filled up with listening to all the noise of the world around us. But another thing of these questions that we ask at the end of the day like that are to help us center ourselves on God and on Jesus and listen for his voice and give him the ability to talk to us, and so we can focus and listen to him and recognize God's presence in our lives, to hear God's voice talking to us, and to try to develop into the hero that we can become for him. In order for us to become that hero for him, we have to turn down the volume or the noise that's all around us to help us focus on Jesus. And if we focus on him and we hear his voice calling to us, directing us, encouraging us, and giving us strength and courage to be his hands and feet as we journey through this world as his disciples, what could go wrong? If we listen to him and we follow his direction, everything will come out all right. Even though we might not see it, God is with us everywhere and at all times. Jesus is right by our side, no matter even if we think he seems far away at that moment. So our question this week is, are you focusing on your relationship with Jesus? Are you growing with him each day? Are you recognizing his presence in your life each day? And even if he seems so far away from you at that time, are you recognizing where he's been at? Are you seeing who you are in Jesus? And if so, if you're recognizing those things, if you're recognizing who you are in Jesus, then the question is, so what's your hero power? What's your special ability? What's your power that you're to be using in the name of Jesus? Is there a Peter in you? Is there a Paul in you? Is there someone else of one of our great leaders of faith? Heroes are ordinary people that do extraordinary things with God's help. What's your hero power? That's something to ponder this week. Amen. Would you be in an attitude of prayer with me? Lord, we just thank you for the many examples that you give us through scriptures. We thank you for sometimes revealing meanings between meanings and make us think and inquire and yes, sometimes listen to those teachings that you give us. And Father, you especially call us into that relationship with you. Help us to recognize where you're at all times and all places within our lives. Even those times when we feel super close to you and those times where we feel so distant from you. But help us to recognize that you are always with us, guiding us, proceeding to us. And Lord, help us to become more like you each and every day. Amen. Let's join together as we meditate on the words of our hymn of response, number 206 in the United Methodist Hymnal, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light.
Thank you.
Normally, this is the time where we bring forward our offerings and tithes and bless them. And so as we reflect back on what God has done for us in our lives, and we think about those tithes and offerings that we present to Him to glorify His name and to bring His kingdom here on earth into a reality and be able to provide services for those who are less fortunate or undergoing stresses in their life, such as hurricanes and floods and earthquakes and fires and all sorts of things and calamities that are going on around the world. And also to help us with giving missionaries money to help them sustain themselves in foreign countries, as well as here in this country as well. Let's join in our doxology this morning. Glory be to the Father. Gracious Lord, we just thank you again for all that you give us. And Lord, we praise you by returning a portion of what you give to us to be used for your kingdom here on earth, to help those in need, help those that are struggling so that they can know just a little bit more about how you love them so much and how you take care of them, Lord, and how you want to be in that relationship with them. We thank you again, Lord, and we just ask that you bless these gifts so that when combined with others, that they can bring that healing touch to someone in need. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. This time we lift up our joys and concerns to the Lord, and I've got a couple this morning. So the family of Shorty Jones, who passed away yesterday, just keep them in your thoughts and your prayers, especially his wife, Nancy. Just keep her in her thoughts. Chuck brought up a couple that he's got a couple friends that are undergoing cancer. One has prostate cancer, and another friend has rectal cancer, and neither one of their outcomes look very good at this point. And then we also have, just coming up this Memorial Day weekend, Labor Day weekend coming up shortly. And I know we've got, so yeah, I don't know why I have Memorial Day on the brain.
I have another. I need to ask prayers for the news dead. It's a praise and a prayer kind of thing.
Okay.
Praise for they finally had the diagnosis for being in that one, and prayers for the fact that it's not what anybody really wanted to hear.
All right. So prayers for Julie's dad for the getting a diagnosis, and also that it's not what everybody wanted to hear. So we understand that, but are there other prayer concerns coming up? Yes?
I do have a joy to add to that.
Okay. Happy birthday, Chuck, a little bit early. And a special landmark day with a zero. Ooh. You're 30?
30 is tough.
I know. 30 is tough, man.
There's a lot of those
zeros. You better believe it. Wait till you get double zeros, man. Yeah. Then you'll have something to celebrate really big, right? Other prayer requests this morning. All right, let's center our thoughts and our prayers on our prayer chorus this morning. It's the Spirit song. It's in the Methodist hymnal number 347.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, we come before you again this day and offering up our prayers of joys, of birthdays and travel, and also concerns as well, because traveling these days can be both a joy and a concern, Lord. So we just lift up those who will be traveling for the Labor Day weekend, Father God, and just give them their protection that they need as they're traveling about. And Lord, we just give thanks for another year around this globe for Chuck tomorrow, that as he celebrates one of those special birthdays with a zero. And Father, we lift up the Nancy Jones and the family of Shorty, who Shorty passed away yesterday. And Lord, we just ask that you give them your comfort and strength, that they can find peace in his passing, Father God. And Lord, for those who are in need of our care and healing, for their friends with a prostate cancer and a friend with rectal cancer, Lord, we just lift them up to you, Father God. Be with them, comfort them, and let them know that your presence is there, even when you might seem far away from them, Lord, that you are there and with them side by side as they go through this. And Father, we lift up Julie's dad, who's finally able to receive a diagnosis, but yet, Lord, it wasn't what we all wanted to hear, and especially the family, Lord. So we just ask your blessing upon him and ask your blessing upon the family, Lord. Comfort them and let them to look forward to ways of healing and comfort, and no matter what forms that may take, Father God. And Lord, there's so many other things that are probably on our hearts and in our minds that we think up and we lift up to you, Father. Especially those who can't be in worship with us, for those in care facilities, and for those that are staying home to and caring for themselves at home, Lord. That isolation can be so difficult for them. Father, we just ask your blessing upon them on this day. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, our hero, as we join together in the prayer which he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's join together as we meditate on our closing hymn today. You are mine. It's in the Faith We Sing, number 2218. Before the benediction, I just wanted to say, since next weekend is our fifth Sunday, if I remember right, of the month, and since we really can't do a lot of things special, I thought maybe we could have worship outside. One of the benefits to having worship outside is we can sing outside if we have our masks on. So, or you can not wear your mask and sing, and I'm not going to say a word. But, you know, if we have worship outside. Now, I looked at the extended forecast, and it's only supposed to be a high of 80 on Sunday. But there is a chance of rain. So, which means that at 8:30 in the morning, it should be fairly nice, maybe in the 70s. Or lower 70s at that time of the morning. So if we get underneath the shade trees and bring your chair, your lawn chair or bag chair, whatever you got, and we can just have a worship service outside, unless it rains or it looks bad out or it's miserable out, that the forecast is wrong. We all know that happens from time to time, right? Could be 80 degrees and 80% humidity by 8 in the morning. So if it's that, we'll still meet inside. Otherwise, we'll meet outside and have worship out there. Does that sound good? All right. Well, let's receive the benediction then. God's blessing on us. May the God who is the hero of our lives, one we emulate, may he guide us and guard us, no matter, and may we recognize his presence in our life no matter where we find ourselves. And may we have the courage to grow into the hero, just like Peter grew into the hero, and go out and serve the world for Jesus. Amen.